and Philosophy Lecture Series. My name is Karen Park. I'm a professor in the Theology and Religious Studies Department here at St. Norbert, and I also serve as chair of the Killeen Chair Committee. Before we begin tonight's event, I just wanted to remind you of one more upcoming event we're sponsoring this year under our theme of economic justice. Our final speaker of this academic year will be on Thursday, March 30th, 2017. Dr. Paul Weithman, professor of philosophy at Notre Dame, will be here speaking on what, if anything, is wrong with economic inequality. That lecture will also be here at the Fort Howard Theater at 7 o'clock, and we sincerely hope that you will also be able to join us for this event. This evening, we welcome Maureen O'Connell, PhD, Chair of the Department of Religion and Associate Professor at LaSalle University. She will be speaking to us about stepping out on faith, economic justice through community organizing. Following her lecture, we will have a brief period of question and answer. And after that, we would welcome you to stay for refreshments to continue the conversation in the lobby outside this auditorium. I'd now like to invite my colleague in Theology and Religious Studies, Reg Kim, to the podium to introduce our guest.
Stop laughing. Is Dr. Chan here? Oh, okay, then we could skip that part. I was going to wish him a happy birthday. Okay, here we go. Dr. Maureen O'Connell is Chair and Associate Professor in the Department of Religion at LaSalle University in the city of brotherly love and sisterly affection, otherwise known as Philadelphia, in the great Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And as we all know, that's the greatest commonwealth in the Union. There are two others only. She is the author of Compassion, Loving Our Neighbor in an Age of Globalization, and If These Walls Could Talk, Community Muralism and the Beauty of Justice, which won the College Theology Book of the Year Award in 2012, and the Catholic Press Association's first place for books in theology in 2012. Her current research project explores racial identity formation, racism, and racial justice in Catholic institutions of higher learning. Before becoming chair at LaSalle, Dr. O'Connell taught at Fordham University in New York City, where both myself and my colleague in theology and religious studies, Dr. Mara Brecht, were trained as graduate students. As a model and mentor for teaching, Dr. O'Connell challenged us to teach by the Jesuit principle of cura personalis, which means care for the entire person, where we engage with our students beyond their intellect and encounter them as fully embodied persons. For her, and subsequently myself and Dr. Brecht, teaching challenges not only the mind, but also engages the actual lived experiences of those around us, and this value is ever present in her research and her activism. Or, to put this through the St. Norbert Mission Statement Translator 3000, her life as a professor reflects our own SNC mission of docere verbo et exemplo, which means to teach by word and example. As Dr. Brecht puts it, and these are her words, when you read Maureen's work, you can feel her faith, commitment to justice, and intellect come through the page. When you see Maureen teach, you have no doubt you're watching a master at work. When you hear all about the great projects Maureen leads and is involved with, you can't help but be energized to get to work on your own projects. And when you're with her, you know you're experiencing the joy of real friendship. I'm very disappointed not to be here for Maureen's visit, but I'm gratified to know that St. Norbert gets an opportunity to be with her and, no doubt, to be inspired by her. Now back to my words. Less eloquent. While Philadelphia is known as the city of brotherly love and sisterly affection, Dr. O'Connell speaks prophetically to those who too quickly claim this attribution without actually working to make her hometown into a city of just love for all of its neighbors. Her research and activism challenges us to truly love where we are by demonstrating this love as more than just the wearing of the jersey of the local sports team on game day or cheering loudly when Bruce Springsteen name checks our city on stage. Instead, Dr. O'Connell asks us to be reflective about our personal and institutional situations as maintaining systems of injustice so that we can better enact a just love in solidarity with our least privileged neighbors. Last weekend, Dr. O'Connell participated in the North American World Meeting of Popular Movements in Modesto, California, the greatest state in the Union. where she heard and shared stories and visions of community building and organizing to work towards social justice. In Philly, she works with a group called Power, Philadelphians Organizing to Witness, Empower, and Rebuild, an interfaith federation of 90 faith communities committed to activism for a more just wage for workers, fair funding for public schools, immigration reform, and decarceration. Dr. O'Connell will be speaking to us tonight on the topic of stepping out on faith, economic justice through community organizing, by exploring some methods of faith-based community organizing. While her theological approach is practical, we should not fall into the trap of thinking it is easy. Engaging with faith-based community organizing as a viable approach to building economic dignity and justice, particularly in the urban communities in the U.S., means that we cannot dodge the reality of racism as a driver of social inequality. Tonight, as she reflects upon some specific ways that faith-based organizing deepens the praxis of Catholic social teaching where economic justice is concerned, perhaps we as individuals, groups, and institutions can be challenged to act in solidarity for a just love for our neighbors. I look forward to this challenge, and I hope you all do as well. Please join me in extending a warm St. Norbert College greeting for our Killeen Chair speaker tonight, Dr. Maureen O'Connell.
So thank you so very much for that very warm welcome. And I've learned in my very short time on campus that the Norbertine tradition is known for hospitality. And I feel like I've been really very warmly welcomed, in addition to warmer temperatures, I guess, that you're experiencing here. And we are apparently at 71 in Philadelphia this evening. But anyway, just wanted to say thank you very much and for the invitation to be here. And also a thank you to Kristen. I don't know where Kristen is, for all of the logistical support. She's magnificent and wonderful, and has really made this just a really great experience so far. So I want to begin with two disclaimers. The first is that I'm not an economist. I can't even balance my checkbook. And so when I tell my father, who still files my taxes for me, I say, I do God, I don't do numbers. It makes my students very nervous around grade time. And then the second thing is that I'm really very much a novice community organizer. So you're probably wondering why, given those two disclaimers, am I here speaking on the topic that I'm speaking on? And to be honest, it's really because the Spirit moves in some really mysterious ways. I offered this topic more than a year ago to the committee who invited me to come and speak with you. And since that time, I was invited to be part of an advisory committee to put together the meeting that Professor Kim just mentioned last weekend in Modesto, California, that brought together 700 community organizers from all over the country to Modesto. So I did not even know that that was going to happen, never mind that it was going to happen the weekend before I was to be with you all. And so that, to me, that's sort of what grace is. That's not a coincidence, I don't think. I think that's actually very intentional. I think there's a lot of things that are going on around the country right now that are like that. There were seeds that were planted. There were steps that were taken to prepare folks for the moments that we find ourselves in right now as a country. And so I count being with you and sharing out what I learned over the weekend as one of those moments. So I'm really eager. I also have to say that I was up really late last night working on this, because I got a lot of this information. I got back on at 1 a.m. on Sunday evening. I had to teach on Tuesday and Wednesday. So I felt a bit like a student pulling an all-nighter. But I'm really happy that I can share out what I've learned from folks who were part of that movement and part of that world meeting last weekend. This is the Philadelphia delegation, so I was not even, it wasn't even a given that I would be selected to go to the meeting, but I was, and I joined some other folks. Most of these folks are with Power that Professor Kim mentioned. So the thesis I really would like to explore with you this evening is built on a fact, on a deadly fact, of the growing income and wealth gap in the U.S. And it sounds like your next speaker might speak about this as well, and I'm sure you've heard about this from previous speakers as well. And I call this a deadly fact thanks to a perspective that was shared with me by one of the protagonistas at this gathering. That's what the Pope calls community organizers. He calls community organizers protagonistas. And so I got this sense of this deadly fact of the income and the wealth gap in the United States from Noelle Williams last weekend. Noelle is an organizer from Cincinnati. She works with an interfaith organization there called BREAD. And she called our current reality economic lynching. And I had not really ever thought of our economic reality in that way. And she said that to me very early on in the small group that she facilitated that I was a part of. And it really stuck with me for the 4 days I was in California. And so I want to unpack what it would mean to say that the economic gap and the wealth gap that we're experiencing in the United States is a form of economic lynching, particularly when that experience or that way of describing it comes from the folks who are most impacted. And she said that this is the case because it causes a slow death to an increasing number of Americans while also functioning as a form of social control. And I think we're seeing in our contemporary political climate instilling a lot of fear right now in a lot of people. So in other words, this growing gap has economic and political and social implications. And so that's what I want to do in my time tonight. I want to spend a little time lifting up the wisdom of folks like Noelle, the protagonistas of social change that I'm coming to learn from and getting to know through my work in community organizing. And I want to make a claim. And this is what I'm gonna put forward, and I'm gonna try to support, and then maybe we can talk about. I'm going to suggest tonight that faith-based organizing offers a solution to these economic, political, and social consequences of the growing income and wealth gap in the United States. In other words, it offers us a way to live up to and out of Catholic social teaching, and in fact, maybe fills in some of the gaps in Catholic social teaching where that tradition and social justice are concerned, and that it enables us to really step out on faith and step into the economic and political and social gaps that we see in our current society and help us to sort of resist the walls, figurative and literal, that we see going up and help us to create bridges instead. And so I'm gonna suggest that we do that, or I'm gonna try to do three things in order to do that. I'm gonna explain briefly the economic, political, and social implications as I see it, again, not as an economist, but as a theologian, of the income and wealth gap in the United States. And Pope Francis has been paying a lot of attention to these gaps as well, so I'm gonna lift him up. Then I wanna explain a little bit about the method of community organizing and adapt the See, Judge, Act praxis of Catholic social teaching. Some of you might be familiar with that. I'm gonna adapt that. I'm gonna say community organizing gives us a different way of thinking about that praxis. I wanna talk with you about that. And then I wanna close with some examples of what community organizers are doing around the economic, political, and social gaps in our economy. So that is the plan. And I want to just acknowledge throughout the really neat thing that they had going on at this meeting last weekend was there was a woman that was drawing all of the plenary sessions that we attended. So she was, as they were happening, she was rendering sort of visible depictions of what she was hearing and what the group was responding to. So they're gonna be interspersed throughout. And so that work is her work. So let's just really quickly talk about what's going on in terms of the economic, political, and social gaps in our economy. I've learned from organizers that statistics, while important for giving us a sense of the landscape, really don't go very far in terms of converting hearts. So organizers would much rather talk in stories than in statistics. But I do think there are a couple statistics that are important for us to just get a sense of what we're talking about in terms of the gaps in our economy right now. So in January, for example, Oxfam reported that it now only takes 8 men to make up the total wealth held by half of those of us on the planet. So 8 men have
more wealth than 3.6 billion people on the planet. The wealthiest 1% of Americans hold more than one-third of our national wealth, while the bottom 90% own just 23%. And Forbes estimates that personal wealth in the U.S. is at about $63.5 trillion. So there actually really is a lot of wealth in the United States. It's just held by a few. According to the CIA, nations with lower income equality than the U.S. include Kenya, India, the Philippines, Iran, Nicaragua, Pakistan, and Egypt. More than half of Americans have less than $1,000 in their savings account right now. And the Pew Charitable Trust reported in November of 2014 that a third of all Americans have no savings whatsoever, right? So that's pretty significant. And that also income and wealth inequality in the United States is raced. According to the Survey of Consumer Finances in 2013, the median white family held 13 times as much net wealth as the median black family and 10 times as much wealth as the median Latino family. And that has spiked significantly in the last 15 years. There's been a dramatic uptick in that disparity. So a quick word, again, I'm not an economist, but just trying to figure out how we got here. There's any number of theories, and hopefully you've heard of some of them, and hopefully the economists and economic majors in the room at the Q&A can sort of fill some things in. But I think there's one idea that really has stuck out to me. And it came from Professor Stephen Pitts at the Center for Labor Research and Education at UC Berkeley this past weekend. And he called our current situation the result of a 40-year beatdown. That's what he called it, a 40-year beatdown. Since the 70s, our economy has been experiencing, or folks in our economy have been experiencing, a 40-year beatdown. And one theory for the cause of that beatdown, posited by a number of economists and economic historians, is the transition of our economy from an industrial-based capitalism to a finance-dominated capitalism. Now, I'm swimming way out of my league, or I'm way over my head here, but there's just one thing that I think is really significant that ties back to what Noel Williams was talking about in terms of economic lynching. What's happened with a move to a finance-dominated capitalism is ultimately it has decoupled capitalism from people making money by producing and consuming goods and transitioned it instead to people making money with money. And that's a really significant change in our economy in the last 40 years and particularly in the last 15 years. And the result of this shift from an industrial capitalism to a finance-dominated capitalism really has been twofold. First, and again, this is as fancy as I'm going to get, and I can't believe I'm even being so bold as a theologian who can't balance her checkbook to throw charts at you about income inequality. But this is just a very simple chart that reflects income, wages in the United States, right? Giving you a sense of how some folks have seen an uptick in wages, but a lot of folks really have not, that wages have remained flat. So that's one of the results of this move from an industrial or production-based capitalism to a finance-based capitalism. The second thing is that's happened is that wealth, there is wealth that's being generated, but that wealth is being generated and captured and kept and retained by a very small fraction of folks in the United States. And again, that's been happening over the last 40 years. And so one of the things that is significant about this in terms of thinking about economic lynching is that this has created a financial disciplining effect on corporations, on governments, whether federal, state, or local, and on individuals. Because the maxim in this economy is to maximize profits at all costs for shareholders, which is a pretty significant shift, again, in a short amount of time in our economic history, maximizing profit for shareholders. And so what this does, in order to maximize that profit, it requires or it demands a kind of fiscal disciplining on a quarterly basis of governments, of corporations, and of individuals. So in short, discipline by finance means downsizing. It means working harder on the employees one has in order to ensure their maximum productivity. It means outsourcing and shifting operations to lower cost sites regardless of community fallout. And it's doing all of this in a very rapid, pace, right? So this is sort of one of the ways of thinking about this beatdown. And again, there are economic implications of this for federal and state governments. So for example, stagnant wages have created tax deficits in municipal and state governments, which forced them to turn to private investors to fill in the gap, and putting governments under these disciplinary pressures that many corporations face, which has led governments to privatize many formerly public goods, things like education, infrastructure, transportation, housing. And then as a result, individuals who are using these services, who are already financially squeezed by their employers' flat-lined wages and increased pressures for productivity and efficiency, experience the cost of maximizing profits here as well. So individuals are forced to take out loans, payday loans, credit card and debt and student loans, secondhand car loans, second mortgages, all of which reduce their ability to accumulate wealth. So those are some of the economic implications of this shift to a finance-dominated economy. That idea of the 40-year beatdown. In terms of political implications, we've seen a transition. Well, despite popular opinion and even economic theory that suggests that some inequality, particularly in capitalist systems, is unavoidable, our current economic and wealth gap is not a given or unavoidable, but really the result of political decisions around economic and monetary policies dealing with deregulation of everything from banks to corporate donations to political campaigns. And I heard an organizer put it this way over the weekend: putting greed over need is a bipartisan value among most elected officials today. So as a result, democracy devolves into a plutocracy, or rule by the rich for the rich. So we just see an increase of money and money creating access in politics. In his book, Blessed Are the Organized, Jeffrey Stout notes the ways in which the elites are now able to translate advantages acquired in the economic sphere, that things such as money, wealth, organizational cohesion, organizational skills, communication technology, and ready access to information, all of that now gets translated into political power, which leaves the rest of us on the outside looking in. Boston College sociologist of labor, Juliet Shore, notes that this economic disenfranchisement leads to the erosion of confidence in our political systems, which in turn instills cynicism and apathy, as well as fear and anxiety. I think we saw that very clearly playing out in our country in the last 2 years with the presidential campaigns. And then finally, all of this has social implications. So some theological ethicists like myself, Ken Himes and Kate Ward, both of who are at Boston College, consider the wealth gap in relational terms. In other words, there is a pulling away from each other or a fracturing of the social fabric of our society, an isolation that occurs as one group outpaces another group, making empathy difficult and creating significant anxieties and frustrations among those who are left behind. There are relational fallouts for this. Last weekend, a sociologist, John Powell, who's at the Haas Institute for Social Equality at UC Berkeley, noted that the anxieties caused by this relational distance fuels our temptation to otherize people and scapegoat people in the ongoing, what he called the ongoing American experiment to define what we mean when we say we the people. He said that's been the ongoing contested question through most of American history, we the people. Who gets to be the we in the people? And those who are deemed not worthy of being part of that we, either because we blame them for their inability to keep up with us financially, or because we blame them for preventing us from doing so, those folks are deemed non-neighbors. And they are relegated to a non-place, which is kind of captured here in this image that Sonia did, this non-place between the public and private sphere. So we have a whole growing number of citizens who are relegated, deemed not worthy of being part of the we, the people, not being seen as being economically viable or productive, and they're relegated to these non-spaces, like prisons, or perhaps like deportation centers, or perhaps failing public schools, right? They are just sent to these places that are sort of deemed no, places of no place. Archbishop Tobin of Newark, the new archbishop there, put it this way last weekend, and I thought this was really profound in terms of the social implication of this gap. The concentration of wealth creates a cycle of alienation and disengagement, which then leads people to find a group to blame and to channel fears and anxieties towards the scapegoats of our day, immigrants, youth, people of color, rather than the architects of the structures of inclusion. So we have fear and anxiety, we're just not targeting that fear or channeling that fear and anxiety in the right direction. So the good news is that in the midst of this bleak forecast, the Catholic social teaching has long had its eye on injustices in our economic system. And we have a very strong tradition of principles, dignity of the human person, work as an expression of that dignity, being made in the image and likeness of God, the solidarity between peoples of the global north and the global south, the haves and the have-nots. We have a very rich tradition. And also, it might not be surprising that Francis, the first pope from the global south, with direct experience of just how cut off many human beings are from our global economy that's so dominated by finance, is also the first to do an analysis of our economic system with a different perspective, and what he calls through the lens of the idolatry of money. So let me just give you a couple things that the Pope has said about these things that I've just named, and then we're gonna jump in and look at how organizing is responding. So in his first contribution to Catholic social thought, Evangelii Gaudium, or the joy of the gospel, the Pope identified these three impacts of our money-obsessed economy that led him to conclude that an economic inequality is the driving source of social ills in our global economy. In fact, he named the economic impact of our current system, and he really didn't pull any punches. I'm gonna quote him. Just as the commandment, thou shalt not kill, sets a clear limit in order to safeguard the value of human life, today we also have to say thou shalt not to an economy of exclusion and inequality. Such an economy kills, he says. He also was able to see, much like Noelle was speaking about when she talked of economic lynching, the disciplining nature of our economy. He says this, and again, I'm gonna quote the Pope from Evangelii Gaudium. A new tyranny is thus born, invisible and often virtual, which unilaterally and relentlessly imposes its own laws and rules. Debt and the accumulation of interest also make it difficult for countries to realize the potential of their own economies and keep citizens from enjoying their real purchasing power. And he speaks of the political implications of this, talking about how it is creating a widening gap between those who participate in government and those who don't, increases corruption in politics. And then finally, I want to give you a quote that he gave to us in a letter. He wrote a letter to this delegation over the weekend. And I think it's really powerful getting at the social implications of a finance-dominated economy. He said, and this again is in a letter from Saturday, sooner or later, the moral blindness of this indifference comes to light, like when a mirage dissipates. The wounds are there, they are a reality. The unemployment is real, the violence is real, the corruption is real, the identity crisis is real, the gutting of democracies is real. The system's gangrene cannot be whitewashed forever, because sooner or later the stench becomes too strong. And when it can no longer be denied, the same power that spawned this state of affairs sets about manipulating fear, insecurity, quarrels, and even people's justified indignation in order to shift the responsibility for all of these social ills onto a non-neighbor. I'm not speaking about anyone in particular, he says. I'm speaking of a social and political process that flourishes in many parts of the world and poses a grave danger for humanity. So that's some serious diagnosing of what's going on in our contemporary context, particularly here in the United States, coming from the Pope this weekend. So let's talk about how faith-based organizing might respond to some of this. The Pope recognizes that we need to start to ask some questions about for whom is the economy functioning and for what purpose. Those are two driving questions of organizing. Who is benefiting from the ways things are operating and to what end, right? And so the Pope is keeping his eye on that. And so in that spirit, he created in 2013 the World Meeting of Popular Movements. He convened the first one. So John Paul II had World Youth Day and started World Youth Day. Benedict XVI and John Paul II both were influential in putting together the World Meeting of Families. This is a new gathering, global gathering. There's been three so far, one in Rome, one in Bolivia in 2015, and then one back in Rome just this past November. And in these meetings, the Pope invites what he calls the social poets of our day, the organizers and the people of social movements, to get involved and to address three themes that he sees as important: land, labor, and lodging. So those are the themes that have been discussed by these world meetings. And in Modesto, the first regional meeting of popular movements, we added migration and racism, since those are really important things in the Catholic experience. So the delegates this past weekend listened to five plenary sessions on those topics that I just mentioned, and here's a picture of a plenary session that was happening. And then after each plenary, we would break into small groups, breakout groups, and talk about the issues that were raised at the plenary. It's important to note that the plenaries were really not made of academics like myself. They were made of protagonistas, people who are directly involved in the work, directly engaged in what's going on. And then each group would report out the findings, the discussions that they had, to the wider whole. And so these were all kind of thrown up on the wall, so everybody could see what the small groups were talking about on these issues. And so here's just like a selection of some things that were coming out of the small groups, things that people were talking about, things that people were hoping to see. And then at the end, each of the small groups sent somebody to a larger working group to create a statement. We called it the message from Modesto that was gonna go to the Pope, was gonna go to the US Catholic bishops, and go to the organizing community, both here in the US and nationally, with a statement of beliefs and then a set of 10 action principles. And I'll come back and talk about some of them in a minute. But there you can see the representatives from each of the working groups reading out the draft of the statement from Modesto. So let me just tell you a little bit about what makes community organizing a little bit different than other approaches to injustice. So it's pretty, I think most of us, particularly in Catholic contexts, are pretty familiar with the direct service approach, right? The folks who have need, there's a need out there, we can meet that need, and we work to meet immediate need. Very important, right? Also, folks in education and in higher education in particular know that raising awareness and educating people about issues is also a really important way of addressing injustice. Having the Killeen lecture on this topic this year would be a great example. Advocacy work is folks that serve as allies. I heard a student today put it that way, and it was very helpful. Serve as allies for folks who are most directly impacted. So standing for, sometimes standing with people, but advocating on their behalf, usually in a kind of legislative context. And then there's organizing, which is something that's really quite distinct and quite different. If I ask people to respond and tell me, where do you think St. Norbert's puts most of its energy it seems to focus a lot of the work that students and faculty do here in responding to injustice, what would people say? What would you say? Where do you seem to put it, where do you at St. Norbert's put a lot of your energy in terms of responding to injustice? Yes. And Mrs. Taylor, yes?
Yes.
Who had the insight about ally, we should say, by the way, and advocacy. Okay, yeah, Taylor.
We do a lot of community service, mm-hmm. like the community hall.
Yeah. Okay, so really important, good volunteering work going on, but we would recognize that that really falls in this category of direct service. So when we start to get down towards advocacy and organizing, the things that make them different is they're about getting at the root causes. Why are people, so many people hungry? Why are so many people dealing with housing insecurity? Why is it that we've got this significant income gap? Right, so let me give you a couple ideas about the how of organizing. So first, organizing starts by building relationships through one-to-ones. People have one-to-one conversations where they share their deepest fears and their deepest laments and their biggest hopes and expectations, right? So a conversation that I had over the weekend, somebody asked me, we were to ask each other, what keeps you up at 3 a.m.? What's the thing that's got you most agitated or concerned at 3 a.m.? And you can't go back to sleep because it's gnawing at you. These are the kinds of things that these one-to-ones attempt to surface. So you've got one-to-ones. The second thing that makes community organizing different is that it's led by indigenous leaders or native leaders. People who are closest to the pain are the ones who are out front advocating for the change, advocating, setting the directions, coming up with the plans, coming up with the action plans. And so that makes this very different. So here's some of the leaders of the social movement or the meeting in Bolivia. And then here's an example of some of those leaders last weekend. This was a panel of people that were talking about the environment. So there is a Native American from the California area who was talking about issues around water after his experience at Standing Rock. He had gone to Standing Rock to be with other people, other tribes. And then this young woman here is from Flint, Michigan, and was talking about the water crisis in Flint. So these were not academics talking about this. This was folks right in the trenches talking about it. So that's something else that makes organizing different. Third, organizing is about analyzing power dynamics, wanting to figure out, again, that question of who is benefiting from inequality. When there is some form of inequality or some form of injustice, there is somebody who is benefiting from that. It is in the financial interests or economic interests of someone or some groups of people to sustain inequality. So organizing wants to figure out who's benefiting so that you can start to make those folks the targets of your frustration, of your anger, of your indignation, not the people who are impacted by that inequality. And so in the United States, we know that race is one of the major factors, one of the driving forces of social inequality in the United States. So organizers in the United States pay an awful lot of attention to racism and the power dynamics of racism. The next thing organizers do is they do something called mapping power. So figuring out the power that is within the community itself and wanting to take advantage of the assets that communities have. Often, communities who are disadvantaged are always told all of the things that they don't have. And that creates a mentality of not being able to recognize all of the different resources that actually exist within the community, so that maybe the community doesn't have to rely on people from the outside, that maybe there are some resources and things that they have right within. And so in this case, this is Thomas Joseph, who was speaking about the power of indigenous spirituality in Standing Rock as something that made it possible for all of those tribes to come together for as long as they did in that place and have a prophetic witness to protect water. He talked about the asset of the deep native spirituality and being able to do that. And then the last thing that organizers do is once they figure out who's benefiting from the power, they work really hard to apply pressure to power brokers in order to make power brokers or people in positions of power be accountable to the community. Be accountable to the community, often the community that they serve. and wanting to resist a vision, perhaps, of the dominant culture and insist on something very different. So this is a little snippet that came from the Pope's letter, where he wants to insist that no people is a criminal, and that no religion is a terrorist, wanting to really resist the labeling that we see that comes out of fear. So this is another way of thinking about some of the steps of organizing, the central questions of organizing. And this comes from Marshall Ganz, who is at Harvard in the School of Public Policy, but he was an organizer with a student nonviolent coordinating committee in the 60s. He worked alongside of Cesar Chavez. He's sort of one of the students and practitioners of organizing in the United States. And so these are the central questions that he recommended that all of us there keep our eye on if we want to be engaged in this kind of change. So I think that organizing is changing the praxis of Catholic social teaching. Catholic social teaching has a three-step praxis in order to do some social justice work, and I want to suggest that Scott offers some different things. I want to suggest that the see step or the observe step becomes resist, the judge step becomes regroup, and the act step becomes reimagine. And that's really convenient because I saw this sign at a Martin Luther King Day rally in Philadelphia a couple weeks ago, and I said, I'm going to make that my mantra for the year. And then it sort of seemed to work really nicely with this framework. So let me just give you a couple ideas of what each of these things mean out of the experience of organizing. So what does it mean to resist? What does it mean when organizers say resist? I think this is a great quote from a guy named Alfred Marshall, who was from an organizing group in New Orleans. He works with ex-offenders. He was once incarcerated himself. And he told us, if you want change, you have to get off your knees and hustle, right? He's speaking to communities of faith. Yeah, prayer is good, but at some point you're gonna have to get out there and you're gonna have to make it work. You're gonna have to get involved in some resistance. So organizers really want to resist the othering that we see going on in our culture. Coming back to that, no person is criminal, no religion is terrorist. It's about resisting othering that relegates people to those non-spaces. It's about resisting the idolatry of money or resisting the myth of white supremacy, or resisting the myth of scarcity, that there's not enough, that there's not enough to go around. If we have $63.5 trillion of wealth in the United States, I'd say there's some stuff that could go around. We might not necessarily be dealing with scarcity. Pope Francis understands resistance in claiming one's identity as a change agent, as I mentioned before, as a protagonista, which is important for those who have been the focal point of social control, but also for those of us who have too long have been on the sidelines and kind of complacent. He calls everybody to be agents of change, to get involved, and to recognize that we can be architects of structural justice. And here's a kind of statement that kind of came out, for this is the first set of ideas that came from that Modesto statement I mentioned before. This is what the group claimed. This is sort of the form of resistance that came out of this gathering this weekend. Here's a collective set of beliefs of the 700 people who were gathered there. You can see that this is a statement in many ways of resisting some of the things that we see kind of going on in our contemporary context. A really powerful statement. So the next thing we could talk about is the notion of judging, the evaluation step of Catholic social teaching becoming regroup. So instead of evaluating and judging, let's try to regroup. So what exactly might that mean? In his address to the Third World Meeting of Popular Movements in Rome back in November, Francis noted the global temptation towards fear and hate and wall building. And at the end of his address, he says, walls that enclose some and leave others out are obviously not Christian. Some citizens hide behind walls, terrorized. Others are excluded, dispossessed, and even more terrorized. Fear is fed and manipulated. And because fear is not only good for business for those who trade in weapons and death, it also weakens us. It throws us off balance. It breaks down our psychological and spiritual defenses. It anesthetizes us to the suffering of others. And in the end, it makes us cruel. So the Pope is really wanting to suggest that walls are things that keep people separated. And in calling for building bridges through love instead, that's what he articulated. He has a vision of Christians building bridges. And in some ways, that's the kind of idea that might come out of notions of regrouping, wanting to build bridges. This is Tracy Blackman. She is a pastor in Ferguson. And she suggests that regrouping in the United States requires listening to other people's pain, particularly the pain of race. And she quoted an African proverb to make her point. She said, until the lion tells the story, the hunter will always win. Until the lion tells the story, the hunter will always win. So her invitation to building bridges was really about very careful listening. And then she also said that for Christians, it might also require some confessing some of the wrongdoing that's been done to people of color, whether indigenous people or enslaved Africans in the history of the church in the United States. It might be about making some confessions so that we can rebuild, so that we can regroup, so that we can cross over the boundaries that keep us separated. And the Pope spoke a good deal about that in Bolivia. And here's a way that we might think about that, what that regrouping looks like from the perspective of Jose Arellano, and that was his picture there, right there. He's with Homeboy Industries. I don't know if some of you maybe have read Tattoos on the Heart by Father Greg Boyle, but it's about Homeboy Industries, and that's Jose. Anyway, this was Jose's way of thinking about regrouping with solidarity, right? That we build a circle of concern that is so big that no one is really standing outside that that circle. And then let me say a thing or two finally about imagining, reimagining. So act with a new imagination. This is one of the community organizers. His name is Juan Grabre. He's Argentinian. The Pope got to know him when he was Archbishop of Buenos Aires. He was the leader of a social movement. The Pope invited him to come to the Vatican to say, hey, do you think we could, well, he might not have said hey, but would you like to come and help me figure out how perhaps to put on a world meeting of social movements? And so Juan was with us from Argentina over the weekend, and he said that the Pope calls organizers social poets, that organizers are inherently creative people, and that they are the people, to use the quote, the Pope's words, that allow people to be the artisans of their own destinies. And Juan said, we're the social poets because we create the resources that the market and the state deny to the people. That there's an inherent creativity that goes on with organizing. And the Pope also said this in his address in Bolivia. He said, you are the sowers of change. Along this path to justice, popular movements play an essential role, not only by making demands and lodging protests, but even more basically by being creative. You are social poets, creators of work, builders of housing, producers of food, and above all, people left behind by the world market. You are for the people who are left behind. So there's a real element of a prophetic imagination that goes on in organizing. And again, this was a nice visual that captured what that meant from Marshall Gans, a transformational vision, an imagination that is critical in terms of listening and carefully attending to the pain of people, but then also daring to dream and to hope and to recognize that even in the midst of all that brokenness, there is still possibility. So I'm gonna very, very quickly give you a couple examples of what this looks like, addressing those three different areas, and then we'll have a little bit of time, I think, for some conversation. So remember I said that wealth gap and that income gap has economic, political, and social implications. So let me give you an example of bridging or addressing organizers, addressing the economic gap. This time last year, Power, the organization that I'm a part of in Philadelphia, had a series of poverty summits, wanting to listen to people who are most impacted by low wages in the city of Philadelphia, to really try to get a feel for what was going on, to try to understand what was going on, to come up with a plan. They had public hearings all over the city. I took a class of students to one of them to hear some of those things. They also had a summit where they had all of the innovators in the city, all of the people who have social service agencies or are running proposing different kind of job initiatives, come and offer what they thought the solutions were to deep poverty. And in the end, after listening to all of this and doing some consultation with professors at some of the local universities, Power released last May this book. It's a booklet called Black Work Matters. And at the end of the day, Power decided that the best way that people of faith can get behind social change and to address deep poverty in the city would be to endorse unions in the city of Philadelphia and work with union workers, many of whom wouldn't even identify as people of faith, to get a living wage. That if the folks who work in the service sector, in hotels, in janitorial staffs, in our hospitals or in our hotels or in our food service, if those folks were able to make a living wage, there would be a significant reduction in deep poverty in the city of Philadelphia. So Power has since then done a lot of work with organizing, and in fact, one of the delegates who came with us from Philadelphia was part of one of the local unions at our airport, working to get folks who work at Obon Pan in the Philly airport a living wage. So it was very interesting to walk through the Philly airport this morning. I had a completely different perspective on what's going on in the economic activity in that place, knowing that so many of the workers there are not making minimum wage, much less a living wage. So that's an example of an economic change. Let me tell you a little bit about a political change. So also this time last year, Power was very concerned that the Pennsylvania state government had not sent down or ratified its budget. We were without a budget for 6 months. It was tied up. The legislators would not vote. The Republican-held legislator would not vote, which meant that there were not funds for education being dispersed throughout the Commonwealth. Wealthier school districts had savings and reserves that they could pull on, but Philly didn't have any of that. So a whole band of folks from Power committed to a 100-day fast around Easter and Passover last year, saying that they were going to fast until the state legislators put forward the budget and had there be fair funding in that budget. And they would go once a week to Harrisburg and hold public rallies, calling attention to the need for access to the budget. So this is an example of citizens getting back involved in the democratic process, people reclaiming their voice, people wanting elected officials to be accountable to them. And sort of bridging that gap of cynicism and indifference or alienation that many people are feeling in the political process. So that was an example of thinking about this in terms of the political ramifications. Lastly, the social implications. This is Lynn. Lynn was in my small group. I had several conversations with Lynn. She works for Aramark at Butler University in their food service area. And she told me a story about how the students of the Black Student Union at Butler University supported the Aramark workers at Butler in advocating with Aramark to form a union so that they also could then have some leverage in terms of wage and in terms of benefits. And she told me that had the students at Butler not stood by the employees of Aramark, she doubted that the university would have gotten behind the workers in advocating for them with Aramark. So that is an example. And then on the flip side, those students now have come to that union to help them think through how the students themselves can start to advocate for some of the things that they think that they need at Butler as students of color. So wanting to advocate for more faculty of color, wanting to advocate for a curriculum that reflects the diversity of the campus, wanting more support in student life for students of color. And the Aramark workers have stood by the students in advocating for that. So an example of not moving past the alienation and the scapegoating and the fear and the wall building and really creating bridges that start to transform that community, that university community. So that would be an example of the way that organizing is sort of bridging that gap. So in conclusion, I just want to give you something that the Pope said to us in Modesto. He said, we find ourselves certainly at a crisis at a crisis point in our country and in our world. But he noted that crisis is both about danger and about opportunity. The danger is clearly that we will continue to dehumanize one another and continue to be dehumanized in this economy. But the opportunity is for people to come together. The opportunity is for a kind of neighbor love that is very real and that is very tangible and that is incarnated in local communities. And so he said he hoped that the light of the neighbor, that the light of love of the neighbor might illuminate the earth with a stunning brightness, like a lightning bolt in the dark, and that it might wake us up and let true humanity burst through with authentic resistance, resilience, and persistence. And so I'm gonna leave you with that. Those are some of the things that I have learned from community organizing. And I'll leave you with a chant that we said an awful lot over the weekend. There is power in the people because the people have the power. Thanks very much.
Time for some questions, and our guests will just take those from anybody.
Yes, sir. I was in New York. I was at Fordham at the time. I was there in 2008. There's a really strong coalition in New York, and I don't know why all of a sudden my slide isn't advancing. Let me see if I can get the. There they are. I see the yellow banner kind of being hung. Of course, the New Yorkers had to be higher than everybody else on the wall of banners. The Northwest Bronx Community and Clergy Coalition has been around for a really, really long time. My sense with organizers is that they don't see elected officials as really the only power brokers. And so I don't know that they were really deflected too much by Giuliani. And in fact, a really great example of what the Northwest Bronx Community and Clergy Coalition is doing right now is creating what they call economic democracy. So they're working with a number of organizations in the Bronx, big industries in the Bronx, to keep the wealth that's generated in the Bronx in the Bronx. And so, yes, political power and political access is one form, but they recognize that economic opportunity and economic access are really what builds power and sustains communities. So my sense is that they don't get distracted or dissuaded or focus only on a particular political candidate or political issue. That they're really focused on what are the power dynamics at work in their own communities. Now, certainly Giuliani influences that, particularly with policing and with stop and frisk. But there was a lot of work that those organizations did to really push back in New York, and have significant changes were made in New York City to stop and frisk as a result of some of this community organizing. But There is a fair amount of opposition among Catholics to organizing. There were 20 bishops there at this gathering, and some of them spoke very prophetically, but that's a small fraction of U.S. Catholic bishops. And it'll be interesting to see how they receive this message from Modesto. and particularly around issues of economic viability for communities and the role the church plays in sustaining economic viability. So thank you for that question. Interesting that you say that. One of the things that came out, point number seven in this message from Modesto, is a desire for popular education. I think we had talked about that earlier this afternoon. So there is a desire for more partnership among academic centers and academics and folks on the ground in order to make, to sort of perhaps democratize education or perhaps even start some people universities. Folks were kind of talking about that. Wouldn't that be neat in a city like Philadelphia that has nothing but universities if there was some sort of joint initiative where students and folks in the communities were learning together some of the skills to do this kind of power analysis or to do the power mapping or to have the skills of citizenship that this kind of work requires. So that was a recommendation, and there's a group of us, there's a little caucus of Catholic universities in Philly that are starting to come together and do that. So we've got four universities and about 50 students who are starting to kind of do that kind of work. And you all here, I looked to see if there was any faith-based community organizing here in Green Bay or even in Milwaukee, and I didn't see anything immediate. But you're not that far. There's a really great Stoker, I forget his first name, at the University of Wisconsin in Madison, has a very interesting approach to sort of educating for social change. And then also in the Twin Cities, one of the strongest faith-based organizing outfits is called Isaiah. One of the strongest in the country is in the Twin Cities. And they're not that far, right? Not that far-ish. My geography is really as good as my checkbook. Randy Stocker, that's it. E-C-K-E-R, yeah. Great. So a Saul Alinsky, yeah. But hey, that's great. I mean, so there's something here, and maybe it's looking for a little rejuvenation or some assistance, or it needs students and probably, yeah, some faculty who'd be committed to working with students in that regard. That's great. What was it called? Faith in Action?
Stronger Together.
Predates that. Yes, back here.
There's also a group called Joshua that does prison reform.
Excellent.
And other communities. My question is, I come from a place where I feel very privileged.
Yes.
I'm originally from Minnesota, and reaching out to people that are not affected by any of this and failing, feels like. So how do you, what method do you help someone see something that
That's a really great question. I suspect that it is affecting them in some ways, just might not be awake to it or aware of it or have been given the opportunity to really reflect. And that if they were to have a one-to-one with somebody who is deeply affected and says, what keeps you up at 3 a.m., the answers to those questions would probably be far more similar, I think, than we often assume. And I have a similar experience. I'm from suburban Philadelphia, you know, totally white Catholic, enclavish bubble, you know. From my own experience, it was finding, you know, perhaps tapping into Stronger Together and working with that community and being an ally in some way in that community, and starting there and learning from Joshua, and recognizing the gifts that you can bring, even as somebody from the outside, as long as the leadership is that native or indigenous leadership, then you know that you are truly being an ally as opposed to an outsider. But I also suspect that the folks who feel like they're not deeply affected by deportation or mass incarceration or flatlined, incomes or the staggering gap in wealth in the United States, we all are really impacted, and the challenge becomes how to ask ourselves those deep questions to name the wounds that we all have. That was a visual that was caught, that Sonia caught. The wounds are there for all of us. They're just more, they're closer to the surface for some than others. Hope that's a great question though, but I hope that, does that help? Yeah, one-to-one conversations are a really great way of kind of getting at the meat of people's lives, at the heart of their stories. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you talk about the haves and the have-nots, and unfortunately today I read about the health care insurance companies, Humana and Aetna, and they weren't in the process of merging or not merging, and there was about a dozen people that pulled in a couple $100 million here, a couple $100 million there, and a couple $100 million here and there. And of course, when the issue of these health insurance things, they got the deductibles and the premiums and what have you, and it gets a little uncomfortable for people to pay for health insurance.
Mm-hmm.
And why is it that whether it's in the financial industry or the insurance industry or the investment industry, the people have a license to steal in one manner, form, or the other? When you shake it all down,
yeah,
there is a tremendous amount of funds which are planned, designed, or
mm-hmm.
what have you, one way or the other.
Yeah.
Somebody ends up with a bundle,
mm-hmm.
and John Q. taxpayer or John Q. citizen pays 30% for some interest and another big pound of money for some deductibles. Or
yeah. I mean, that's a really good question. Again, remember, I'm not a checkbook balancer. I could give you a set. I read a summary that a theologian did a survey of some recent books on the economy, written in 2014 and even more recent than that. And it was almost like, imagine finance for theological nerds. So she was trying to take this very complicated language and make it distillable or understandable. And her basic argument is that in a finance-dominated economy, as opposed to an industrial, focused economy, it's really simply about maximizing, the end goal is maximizing profits for shareholders, not even stakeholders. Stakeholders are people who have, some kind of access or skin in the game in the company itself. So if your end goal is about maximizing profits, you're going to figure out all of the different corners that you can cut to do that, to cut costs and increase on a quarterly, having to report on a quarterly level what your yield is. And if people are going into debt, there's actually more money to be made in a money-making economy, an economy that makes money with money on debt. There's more money to be made with debt in a finance-dominated economy. So it really becomes a sort of self-sustaining sort of system, but we're all squeezed, we're all disciplined in this, and the healthcare industry would be one really great example. And maybe you can let the next speaker know that they could come with a thought about that, because they're going to talk about some of the implications, it sounds like, of what's going on with this gap. So thank you.
Okay, we're going to have to continue our conversation, maybe upstairs with some refreshments. If you could all join me again in thanking our guests, Dr. McDonald.